Amen and praise the Lord. Today is the 10th online service, and one thing I can say is God has been good to all of us. God is in total control, and He has showered His blessings on each and every one of us. Not everybody had a good time. Some people struggled. Some people went through hard time. Personally, I've also been through a lot. But even now, I can stand and say that He is good, and His favor rests on those who put their trust in Him. Let's look into the Word of God at this time. There was a time I was going through a season of failure, a season of difficulty, and somebody handed me a note. And the note read like this: "You are facing problems in your life because you do not know who your God is." It made sense to me. I think, you know, some of us, we go through sickness in our life just because we do not know that our God is Jehovah Rapha, God our healer. Some of us face lack in our life because we do not understand that God provides for us. Yet when I continue to dwell on this particular phrase, it made me think. At that time, I was born again, I was spirit-filled, yet facing difficulties and failure in my life. It made me think, can a child of God, can a spirit-filled child of God know God and understand the things of God and still miss out on the plans that God has for him or her? I read into the Word of the Lord, I dwelt on the Word of the Lord, and today I want to share some of those instances in the Word of the Lord where people, in spite of being very close to God, missed out on the promises of God. I will also look at those instances where God ministered to people like that, whose lack of faith or lack of focus created a lot of problems, and how God restored them. I just believe that, you know, God is going to restore a lot of us. God is going to minister to us as we dwell on the Word of the Lord. Remember, the choices we make determine the course of our life. The choices we make determine whether we are in or out of the will of God. Three examples I would like to talk about this time. Example number one, Abraham and Sarah. Abraham was 75 years old when God spoke to him and God gave him a promise. And the promise is a powerful one, the Abrahamic promise. I will bless you and I will turn you into a blessing. Genesis chapter 12 talks about this. Let me read a few verses for you. I will make you into a great nation and I will bless you. I will make your name great and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And all the people on the earth will be blessed through you. God spoke to Abraham and said, you will be a great nation. 75 years he was when the Lord gave him this promise. And Abraham believed. Abraham just trusted the Lord. And for the next 10, 11 years or so, he continued to believe in this promise of God. 11 years later, when he was around 86 years old, suddenly things and circumstances changed. He would look at himself, Sarah would look at herself, and they would think, you know, I mean, we have passed the age of childbearing. There is no hope to us. They looked at themselves and suddenly the focus shifted away from the promises of God to their own inabilities. Sarah would recommend that, you know, I mean, Abraham father a child through the Egyptian slave Hagar. They had Ishmael and it created a lot of complication, lot of problems. In those 11 years, somehow they waited, and they started looking at themselves instead of trusting in the promise of God. Again, fast forward a few years later, God would speak to Abraham again. Genesis chapter 17. God changes the name from Abram to Abraham. God talks to Abraham and says, look at the stars in the sky. Look at the grain of the sand. That's how many children you will have. And from that day, his name was changed to Abraham, father of many nations. For some time he went around telling, I am father of many nations. You know, they say that whatever you say is what you get. Your confession will be your possession. Abraham said it again and again, again and again. Genesis chapter 18, the angels come to visit Abraham. And the angel says, next year by this time, Sarah will be with child. You know what she does? She hides behind the curtain and she laughs. Will this old lady still bear children? And the Lord says, Abraham, why are you doubting the promise of God? God had to intervene and remind Abraham about who he is. God speaks to Abraham and he says, is there anything too difficult for the Lord? Is there anything too hard for the Lord? What's the problem here? Abraham looked at himself. Sarah looked at herself. And they have decided that this is not natural. In the natural way, in the normal way, this thing is not going to work out. But the Lord intervenes and the Lord says, is there anything too hard for the Lord? A year later, he fathers Isaac. And then he worships God. Then he knows that God is in total control. Now, sometimes we look at ourselves, we look at our inabilities, we look at our shortcomings, and we start doubting the promises of God. For some of you, if you're going through that phase, God is talking to us. And the Lord is telling, it is not about your ability, it is not about your potential, it is about God's potential. God talks to you and God tells, is there anything too hard for me? You know, way back in 1918, there was a hymn that was written. And the hymn went something like this. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of this earth will grow dim in the light of his glory and grace. We need to focus on Jesus. We need to take hold of the promises of God at this time. For some of you who are losing hope, take hold on the promises of God. Heaven and earth will pass away, but his word will remain. Let's look at another example. Israel was in captivity in Egypt, was in bondage in Egypt for 400 years. But towards the end of that bondage, they saw the great deliverance of the Lord. They saw plague after plague hitting Egypt. They saw the mighty miracles of God. And not just that, when the Lord delivered them out of Egypt, they saw the mighty Red Sea split. The great Egyptian army, the mightiest army of those times, all of them drowned in the mighty Red Sea. They danced and they rejoiced. And you know, God gave them a promise. Exodus chapter 13 talks about it. Let me read some verses for you. By the day the Lord went ahead of them in a pillar of cloud to guide them on the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, so that they could travel by day or by night. Neither the pillar of cloud by day nor the pillar of fire by night left its place from in front of the people. Daytime or nighttime, God guaranteed his presence. The great deliverer, the great redeemer, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob delivered them out of Egypt, and every day, all the time, his presence was leading them, his presence was guiding them. Yet when they came to Kadesh, the Israelites sent 12 spies into the land of Jericho. 40 days the spies, they scout the land of Jericho, and they come back with a report. And the report of the spies went something like this. Numbers chapter 13. This is what the spies said. But the people who live there are powerful. We can't attack those people. They are stronger than we are. The land we explore devours those living in it. All the people we saw are of great size. 10 of those spies, they gave this report. Many people say that whatever this 10 spoke is actually the truth. They were really giants. They were really powerful. They were really strong. But there's a problem in the way they reported. They did not give the report of the Lord. Joshua and Caleb said, "We can go and take that land because God has promised." And who was leading them? God was with them all the time. The focus shifted from how great God is into how great the people of Jericho were. Somehow the focus shifted. That's the mistake. They believed in what they saw and what they heard. 40 days, their focus was on the people of Jericho and the things of Jericho. The focus was not on the promise of God, except Joshua and Caleb. I don't know where our focus is right now. Are we looking at our problems? Are we looking at our enemies and telling God, my enemy is so big, my enemy is so strong, and I'm so tiny, so puny in front of my enemy? Or are we like Joshua and Caleb telling God, no matter how big my enemy is, you are stronger than my enemy? I think sometimes we should look at our problems, we should talk to our problems and tell, my God is bigger than you. My God is stronger than you. The creator of the entire universe, the creator of the ends of this universe, he is the God who is leading me. He is the one who is guiding me. Ron Kennelly sang a song, and the words of the song go something like this: whose report will you believe? And the answer to that is, we shall believe the report of the Lord. Your enemy might be strong, but if the Lord said that he will give that land as an inheritance, it belongs to you. Whose report will you believe? Will you believe the report of the Lord, or will you believe what everybody is talking about your enemy? Sometimes, you know, we like the spies of Israel go into our land. 40 days they looked at that land and they got scared. I think all that they had to do is just believed in the promise of God. There was a story I heard when I was in Sunday school, and the story was something like this. A small girl was required to memorize Psalm 23. She was so nervous, she was so tense. Though she memorized it, when she finally stood on the stage to recite it, all she said was, "The Lord is my shepherd." She fumbled for some time, and then she said, "This is all I know," and she ran off the stage. I think in many ways, she revealed a powerful fact. All she said was, "The Lord is my shepherd, that is all I know." I think instead of focusing on the great big difficulties around us, I think all we can do is, God, you are my protector, you are my shepherd, you are my provider, you are in control of my life, O Lord, and that is all I know. You have promised me, and that is all I know. My brother, my sister, focus on the promises of God. Sometime turn your attention away from the problems that surround us and focus on the word of God, focus on the promises of God. The third example I would like to talk about. Peter saw Jesus Christ. He heard the words of Jesus Christ. He saw the miracles that Jesus was doing. In Matthew chapter 14, you will find a time when Jesus multiplied the bread and the fish. 5,000 people were fed, 12 basketfuls leftover of food. Peter sees all of these things. And after that, all of the disciples get on into a boat and they sail on the lake. Jesus stays back. He wanted to pray. In the night, while they were somewhere midway, strong breeze, strong wind start rising up. Everybody in the boat is scared. Everybody is terrorized. And suddenly they see Jesus coming walking on the waters. They get scared because nobody walks on waters. But Peter had this faith. He says, Jesus, if you're really there, let me also walk on the waters. He gets down the boat and he walks towards Jesus. But after some time, he looks at the waves around him. He hears the wind blowing. And then he starts to sink. Starts crying to God, God help me, God help me. Jesus stretches out his hand. He lifts up Peter and he says, why are you afraid? Why didn't you trust me? Then they all get onto the boat. The storm is calmed and they start worshiping Jesus Christ. What made Jesus, somebody who's so close to Jesus Christ, somebody who's so intimate with Jesus Christ, suddenly start sinking? Why? Because his focus was not on Jesus. For as long as he focused on Jesus, he walked on waters. But when his focus shifted away from Jesus onto the waves around him, he started sinking. When doubt entered his mind, he started sinking. When he got scared by the things around him, he started sinking. You know, somebody said that fear erases faith and faith erases fear. Let me say it one more time. Fear erases faith and faith erases fear. You choose what will erase what in your life. Are you going to allow fear to erase the faith you have in God, or are you going to let your faith in God erase the fear, the insecurity? Are you going to allow that faith achieve great things in your life? Make that choice. Three examples that we have looked at. We looked at Abraham and Sarah. We looked at the Israelites in the wilderness. We looked at Peter walking on the water. All of them faced problems in their life. Abraham looked at himself and his wife. He looked at how nature behaves. He looked at what is normal and he concluded telling, this is not going to happen. We are never going to have children. This is impossible. But the Lord spoke to Abraham and he said, is there anything too hard for me? To the Israelites, God promised, I will go before you. I will be with you. I will lead you. You will possess the promised land. To Peter, Jesus asked the question, why do you doubt me? Why can't you put your trust in me? My brother, my sister, this is the same question that we face today. Why can't we trust him when we go through difficult times in our lives? He is God who has never failed in the past. When his people stumbled, they staggered and they slipped, God intervened to remind them, put your trust in God, for with him everything is possible. He guarantees his presence in our life. He says, please do not be afraid. I am with you in the storm, in your worst possible situation. I am with you. Make a choice, my brother, my sister. No matter what you're going through, God has a plan for you. God can do anything he wants. Might seem impossible for you, might seem impossible for me. No matter what my situation dictates to me, I'm going to put my trust in the word of God. His promise for me is all I will believe in. For some of you, you have joined this service for the very first time. and you have not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, now is the time. For some of you, you've been part of this church and you have still not received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You have not invited Him to be your Lord, your personal Savior. This is the time. Why do you want to journey alone when Jesus says, I will come with you? When Jesus says, I will go before you, I will lead you, I will guide you. Take this time. I specifically want to talk to those people who are yet to invite Jesus into their lives. Why don't you just close your eyes with me and repeat this prayer? A prayer of confession, a prayer inviting Jesus into our hearts. Please repeat this after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner and I ask you for your forgiveness. I believe you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I turn from my sins and invite you to come into my heart and life. I want to trust you and follow you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have prayed this prayer inviting Jesus into your life, why don't you just click the button in the chat box right next to the screen. Somebody will be there to assist you, pray with you and all. This is an important decision when Jesus comes into our life. And for all of those people who are facing hardships in your life during this lockdown period, I'm telling the promises of God are yes and amen. He's going to do something good. He's going to do something new. Even if you're facing your worst nightmare at this time, He will shine His brightest light into your life. Let me close with a word of prayer. Father, I just thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your love. Thank you for the way, oh God, you lead us and guide us, oh God. Some of us are struggling, oh God. Some of us are going through pain, oh God. Some of us, oh Lord, have lost a lot, oh God, during this lockdown, oh Lord. Yet our eyes are focused on you, oh God. Our hopes are in you, oh Lord Jesus. God, I just pray, oh God, for all of us who have put our trust and our hope in you, that you will lift us up, O Lord Jesus. You will be more closer to us, O God, than any time before, O Lord. O God, I just pray that you will surround us with the warmth of your bosom, O Lord. God, I just pray, O Lord, for those of us who are not feeling anything, O God, not sensing anything in the physical or even in the spiritual, O God. Father, I just pray that the one thing that will be real, O God, in our life will be your presence. Spirit of the living God, come talk to us, O God. Somebody, O God, somebody out there, O God, is crying for you, O God. Somebody is going through depression, O God. Somebody is discouraged, O Lord. And God, all we need at this time is you, O Lord. All we need is you, O God. Come minister to us, O God. Come, O Lord Jesus, intervene in our situation, O God. And through it all, be glorified, O Lord. Through all of these things, O God, be magnified, O Lord. To you belongs all the glory, the honor, and all of the praise. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.